comments? Okay, item two is, I guess there was a question the last time on this file system for the registrar voters. And you just want to explain it to us, or?
We can have it. It has to come up and give pictures.
Of course. Want to see the back of your head later tonight.
Thank you very much.
At least you don't have a bald spot, right? Yeah, there was something.
Last month, you had the transfer. I have the letter if you need a copy, yeah.
If I remember, the question was mainly, is it something that's required or desired?
A little bit of both.
Just give us an overview of what it's all about.
We purchased our filing cabinets several years ago, and we had to change over our cabinets. Our cabinets were old, they weren't closed, and they weren't fireproof, the whole thing. We never gave much thought to putting cards in them, the regular file cabinets. Now, the voter cards are a standard size, I'm not sure you've seen them, what size are they? Whatever they are, the voter cards. They sit down inside the file cabinets. So now to get into them, we are literally like this in there trying to do the files. Then the whole thing changed when they changed the system.
The cabinets that we have now are not made for the file, the registration.
They're not made for voter cards, but they were new files, and we wanted to use them, so. Then they changed the voting, of course, and we have the ballots now that we have to store. Now we have paper ballots, we never had that before. And we are required by state statute to retain them for different lengths of time. Depends if they've been used, if they haven't been used. Some are 2 months, some are extra ballots that we use. We only have to keep them for a certain number of times, but it's all different times. It depends on when the election was and how long you have to keep them on.
We have those regulations.
Do you have to keep them by person?
No. I'm talking about the ballots.
The paper ballots.
Now the ballots, those big ballots that you did.
When you went into vote, you filled in. Those have to be retained. For an election, it's 22 months. You have to store them. They have to be safe. They have to be sealed. They cannot be opened by anybody.
They're not even supposed to be out.
We're not even supposed to look at them. Right now, we have them in cardboard boxes on the floor in our office. We'd be happy to take it down there and show you. And we opened up the vault so you can see it. And we are, believe it or not, have already done 4 elections since we started voting. We have 4, we have 2 firehouse referenda. They're all pretty separate, just in 22 months. So then they said,
was that 4 times?
Right, and it depends on what kind of election was. There's different retention rates for each.
So we don't have any filing cabinets.
So we thought we would, if we could put them into the fireproof cabinets that we have, we could get a card file that's specifically made for voter cards, which is where you can go in and just actually look at them or take out the drawer if you need to transport them, if you had to take them over to the elections, or if you wanted to just take them out and put them in your office so you could file or do whatever. It is accessible. These are made for the voter cards.
$11,000, is that correct? This is what they offer. We have two people recommending this gentleman, Ron Keith. I believe it's also the other two funds. Is it because it's fireproof? Is that why it's fireproof? It is. Well, it's not just. They're specifically made. They're actually made for whatever. I can pass this around if you make copies of it.
Many of the other systems don't hold and don't hold the actual cards. The cards are heavy and they need to be a certain weight. The metal needs to be a certain weight to be able to hold the systems that we have. All of our records are very, very heavy.
Plus these have inserts in them. So the cards
will sit up in a pile
for us to be able to actually get to them.
And if you had to bring them across the street to the voting, you could also take them out to bring them across
the street. We've stuck shoeboxes in the file cabinets. They don't work. They fall apart. I went to Home Depot and brought strips to try to make it separate. They smush into each other. The file cabinets are not working for us, and we thought this is a perfect opportunity to switch over the money that we had put aside for 6 years, the $15,000, 6 or 7 years. It's in that original letter that's attached to your letter. It was in 2001. It's $15,000 that we have been holding on to. to for voting equipment. It turns out the state and the government, whatever, paid for the voting equipment, so now we'd like to use a portion of that and then give the rest back. And if you want to go down and see it and...
The truth is, the way it is now, that it really is not only a fire hazard, it's probably illegal, because we do have adjusted cardboard boxes all over the floor, and they're piling up, and we can't even pull out our drawers to our cabinets now, because there's things all in front of it, and our safe is very narrow. So we're kind of climbing over things to get at.
Are they going to fit in these guys?
We have a whole section that we've cleaned out. We got rid of a desk that was in there that will fit these cabinets, and then everything will be in the cabinet where it belongs.
I'm saying, are these big voting?
Yes,
yes.
We took out a desk.
It's going to fit.
We took out a desk so that this would fit
in the big drawers.
Yes,
it will fit in the drawers, yes.
And then we can label the drawers as far as what year they have to come out and be removed. So we know this whole draw gets removed and then it's room for another one. We have the presidential election coming up, you know, or the primary.
Just separate primaries.
We just have visions that it's safe and wouldn't be able to open the door for us.
Stephanie was telling us some of the towns in the state she's heard are building rooms, adding on rooms.
Believe that
or not. We get to store these ballots, so be lucky we're good when we are.
I'm sorry, it's the room. He's calling. I apologize.
Thanks, Phil. Can you just talk about what this is coming from, the machinery, the voting machines? This is one
that, back before I arrived, there was this process called prior year appropriations, and what you would do is the Board of Selectmen, Board of Finance would set up a called a prior year appropriation, and it would basically reserve funds for specific purposes. This is the only one left. So when I arrived, and it was because of the fact that we weren't sure when, if ever, we were going to need voting machines, if we were, who was going to pay for them.
That was actually when Pam Lessinger was here, because her and I did this together, and it was in 01 that it got moved into this account,
right?
Because we kept reporting it every year.
And then the state ended up paying for the voting machines.
The federal government paid for the voting
machines.
There is one piece of good news. We did get from Ron Keith with DuPont Systems a possibility they're willing to give back $1,000 to the town for voting supply storage. So we're not really sure if that'll cover the file cabinets or if it's going to cover the machines, but hey, we'll send it in. $1,000 is $1,000.
DuPont Systems is a state vendor.
Election storage or something.
State vendor, so.
So we'll try.
And that's another thing that's out is our new voting machines, which are just sitting on top of the cabinets. And in a, you know, because it's just the computer itself, we put it on top of a ballot box, which is the big unit, but that doesn't have to be, it can stay over at the elections. So they're right now just sitting out there kind of hanging out because we have no place to
go. They'll fit. They will fit also in these file cabinets just fine. So we'll be happy. Absolutely. We would have come. We didn't know.
Yeah, actually, in your original letter, you requested this appear, but they didn't act, so that's okay. All right. No, in your original letter, you requested
you said we would come.
Yeah, you said you appear,
right?
But nobody bothered to send out for us, so.
Okay.
Anything else?
Is the cost reflective of these being fireproof or rated fire retardant for X hours?
I don't know how they're
fireproof, and they're also a heavier duty. A cabinet. There's not a lot of vendors for this sort of stuff that we need.
Can you find this original letter?
Heavy duty cabinet that'll hold the weight.
They are fire king current file shelving system. Fire king cabinets we have now.
And it's also for the inserts. And the inserts is what lifts up the cards so that they're accessible and could be moved out. So that's the additional cost. I don't remember how much the inserts are.
UL class 125, 1 hour specification for insulated record protection. Total peace of mind and affordable price.
Affordable.
It depends on what affordable is.
Total peace of mind is in that.
A lot of
peace. I'm just not creative by the warning about these things sometimes. The mess we have downstairs right now. So it says that's a UL 1 hour fire and impact rating listed. So, little card.
Are there any other questions for our registrar? Okay, we'll be voting on this down the road. So.
Okay.
Thank you for coming.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. tonight or later or?
It's on the agenda.
It's the only one we have to vote on.
Oh, okay. So.
Yeah, it's another 10 or 15 minutes.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much.
You have nothing better to do.
Yes, I am.
Now we got more.
It's only those calls.
Yeah, it was pretty good that night, wasn't it?
Favorite place.
You got the same thing I did, or I had the same thing you did.
Alan, the.
Deal.
Has to have it. It's very good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, finance director report. Status of the '07.
Our auditors finish their field review tomorrow. And we're hopeful to have a draft probably by the end of November. And so we're ahead of schedule this year. And so far, all's going well. There's no issues that have been identified that are major consequences. And the annual monthly report, I wanted to bring your attention to a few highlights. On the revenue side of the budget, if you recall the budget process, the state aid was a considerable discussion about where we would wind up and how it would end up. And we had put in some figures that were, we thought were on the high side. And as it turns out, our projected deficit in the state aid is about $16,000, which is not bad considering we were at some point quite high, if you remember.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that actually worked out in our favor there.
They'll make up for it with the bond.
That's a good point, right? It impacts Amity, I think, a lot more than us, though.
Yeah, we talked
about it. But oh, yeah. We had to go out early for a bond issue.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. In department charges, we had a return $37,000 to a developer for revenue collected in the prior year that we shouldn't have collected. So the appropriate accounting entry there was against revenue, which is because that's what we're returning. It's not an expenditure to the town because it's money we collected we shouldn't have collected. So you'll notice in one of our revenue accounts, it looks like we have a large negative balance. It's on page, let's see. Page 4. Find it for you. Just so if you see it in there, you're not shocked. What the heck is going on? What is going on? That's not page 4. It's, there it is. On the bottom of page 2, you'll see there's a $30,000 budget for zoning, hearing, and regulations. And we have a debit. You see, it should be a credit there. And we have a debit of 33, so that reflects that payment. So, just so you know. And that's probably the one item so far in department charges that we've seen a large variance to.
Tony, that was
for AAA.
Isn't anything like this situation in Madison where they're.
No. It was for a fee for a road that was never, that wound up getting eliminated from the.
Segment.
Yeah, the plan. And finally, the $400,000 we've received from CLP is not, I didn't include it in the projection. There was a discussion at the Board of Selectmen about possibly earmarking that for open space and for the purchase of the phase 3 of the Racebrook track. So, as you've probably read, we received a grant for $451,000 for phase 3 of the Racebrook track. So, and the cost is just shy of $900,000. So.
Funded.
Correct.
Yeah.
This funds the.
Then we wouldn't have to worry about.
Yeah.
Funding.
It's 776, I think, is the cost. That sound about right? Yeah. So we'll, the two of them combined will actually be more than what we owe. We were pleased about the grant.
You been following that? I think it's in Madison.
I have actually.
Building fees, is that going to impact us? Are recharging?
Well, I asked Terry about it, and he said. I said, well, what about our fees? Are they similar to Madison? He said, they're almost identical.
Really?
Yeah. But the one difference is in Madison, the building official sets the value. In Woodbridge, the person applying sets the value. That's a significant difference.
Okay.
Sure. What?
The Madison challenge, a contractor challenged that Madison's building fees are excessive. And the court agreed. So they're going to agree that their charges are excessive. So this they're saying it could have a ripple effect throughout the state.
It may.
Yeah.
It may. I know Terry said that was one big difference from the way ours is.
But what Tony's saying is that, in other words, if you apply for a permit in Woodbridge, you put a value on it.
Right. You estimate how much you think the work's
worth. Whereas in Madison, the building is worth it. So that's a big difference.
So that can go the opposite way, too, because that somebody's on the country.
But it is, I guess it's kind of earth-shattering that the board agreed with this.
The basic principle is that the total amount of fees generated should be approximately equal to the cost of operating the park.
Right.
And in Madison, it was a lot more. Now, Madison is saying, well, you can't look at just the cost of operating that department.
Right.
You have to look at related departments.
Right. Sure.
That contribute to it. And the court didn't buy that.
They didn't, huh? Like finance, administration, all the other supporting departments.
Yeah, right. Because it seems like you're going to be able to allocate a portion of those.
Sure.
Sure. We also have cost analysis here for Woodbridge.
We've done one. We did one in the past for when we were trying to figure out how much it costs per hour in relationship to how often you spend over the amenity site. And so we have the figures. And if you add all that stuff in, it's quite
just a FYI. I'll just see how that shakes out as far as the.
Just feedback also to the 400,000 house. Because this is an 09 expense, correct? The open space.
Right. So we have to do it at a town meeting. You'd have to transfer the monies from the general fund to the open space fund, which is a capital fund that does not, you know.
Well, would we do that in the 07 year, or can we wait for that to flow through?
If you don't do it in the current 08 year, then it'll go into fund balance. And then you'll have to do an allocation for fund balance,
True requirements, I mean,
which would also require. Right.
Tony, I thought that the third payment was due in calendar 07.
The third payment for
open space.
It's due December of 09 for phase three.
So we've got another year.
Correct.
09, it was 2 years.
2 years.
Yeah, because we're in 08-09.
Right.
I thought it was the end of this calendar. Good.
I guess if the Board of Selectmen decide to move the 400,000 combined with the state grant,
that's more than we have.
So that's going to make it.
We do more.
Yeah. No effect on the taxpayers.
Why would we have to do more of that?
Oh, you would. I'm just saying the two combined is more than what
we have. It's just bookkeeping. It's just transferring from.
Right.
Just that I think we've got some money built into the budget in the capital plan for open space.
Well, that's just.
You don't have to, which is a good thing.
Yeah, that's a consideration, sure.
Yeah. So. Okay. Anything else, Tony? Any questions for Tony?
I only have it says police department.
I have one more thing to highlight.
I'm sorry.
On expenditures. We do have the police department. Which has its, you go through this every year. They do have a few vacancies. They've filled a couple. They still do have two out on workers' comp. There's one should be back, hopefully a couple months, and another one, I'm not sure, for a while. So
the overtime is up, but the regular is
wages are down. Right.
It's always the way it is.
Usually, they usually accept wages. They never have a full complement.
Right.
And, the other thing is on health insurance. We did a very aggressive bidding this year. We were able to actually get a lower rate than what we did at budget time. So we did a lot of things to try to reduce that expenditure. So the result of that is about $100,000 combined in all three accounts of a surplus approximately. And so I didn't include in here because we have to have this board, the Board of Selectmen, have to have a discussion about our GASB 45, which is the town has to recognize pension and healthcare liabilities on their books. And as you recall, Amity had done some work on that. And we have a study that's it's a draft state. So at some point we'll have some final numbers and then we can.
Does this mean that
we have to budget it in this budget cycle in order to, if we want to?
No, I remember that. That's not what I was going to ask. I was going to say, we experienced the savings. Does this mean that our Board of Education also experienced the savings?
I do believe that they have a savings. You would have to discuss. You probably want to ask them that question. Just because I'm not sure, like,
we don't choose the same broker?
We do, but they budget. We've voted on this before. Their budget is in given to you much earlier than ours is we change our rate up to the last minute. So I'm not sure like where their budget is compared to.
We're gonna have a discussion of that later.
You're gonna ask an answer here.
That's chuckling,
yeah.
Yeah, I just didn't know.
That's a good question.
Yeah. But they have the same GASB 45 issue as we do. Mm-hmm. And so it's gotta be.
So they have to, eventually we have to address that there also.
Correct. And we have to fund it in 09. So that's the budget, if you want your decisions to fund it, of course. I know Amity set up a trust.
We know what other towns are doing yet, Tony, on this particular issue.
A lot of towns are setting up a trust. That seems to be the general thing, because with a trust, you have more flexibility in your interest income, because it's similar to a pension where you can invest it in some broader types of things. You get a higher rate of return because a lot of it you don't need for 30 years, whatever. So a lot of towns are doing that, and that's a kind of you attack it two ways. First, you fund it, and then you seek ways to reduce it, because now you have it identified. So you can say, well, now look at this liability going out. You know, how can we reduce it? Well, you can increase co-pays. Now you have a concrete number that can increase the age, and the amount of years you have to be here. You can. There's a lot of things you can now identify in a negotiation process to say, look at this liability.
You're talking about negotiation with unions.
Correct.
Okay, and also just if you look at the, I guess through September 30th of 07, the Woodbridge budget, Board of Education, is showing $40,000 surplus in there.
I remember him telling me he had a little bit of a surplus.
Yeah. On page F2, line 270.
Yeah.
It was
$40,000.
Benefits. Yeah,
benefits. Okay. And overall, 37.
Yeah, so that's.
So that's about the bulk of what they're.
That's the bulk, right.
Okay. All right, first of all, any other questions for Tony on his monthly report? And then we also have the Beecher. I don't have any questions on the Beecher or comments.
Well, has everybody received the October 22nd capital request from the Woodbridge Board of Ed?
It's not
Woodbridge,
it's
kind of
the
presentation.
The mail, right?
The presentation tonight.
Yes.
Is $1 million more than it was in the blue packet we received dated the week before?
I didn't have a backup.
Well, this thing here.
Oh,
represents 6.4 million, and there is 7.4 million in the packet that I picked up Tuesday morning.
The one we just got?
Yeah.
We're going to be talking about that tonight. So. Were you able to see what the differences were in that? I'm just curious what it is. Let's see.
Don't run. Up and down all over the place. You got replaced ceiling tiles, that's up by 140,000. The windows went down by 75,000. I mean, you got variances. Well, here's the two big ones. Roof not addressed in 2001.
Yeah.
And portable classrooms. So I don't understand what the portable classrooms is, but there's
500,000. Right? Well, yeah, we're going to be talking about that.
Right.
We'll be here tonight. We can ask all the questions. Right. Okay. Funding requests. We just have that one.
Just the one, right?
Which we talked about before, which we heard about tonight. Again, it's not a new funding request. It's a line item transfer. It's coming out of the $15,000 we originally budgeted for new machines, which ultimately were paid for by the federal government. So. I will move acceptance of line item transfer 07-08-05 in the amount of $11,550.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I seek direction only because I'm related to an employee of the registrar's office and wonder if it's appropriate for me to vote. If anyone has any input, I left voicemail for the first selectman this morning, but wasn't able to reach him.
For good of the town, not for the good of the employees.
Well,
right, there's no
that's a big that gets into a discussion that, that's this particular case. We're gonna go through every single case. To me, if you're related to somebody, you've got to abstain.
There's gonna be a problem.
I have no worries, but just a soft direction.
I don't think it's gonna be a problem.
Tony's abstaining in the past.
I've always felt that, it was directly gonna benefit your wife, I think. But it's really a benefit from the town, but I have no problem. It's not gonna be a problem, so.
Very good, thank you.
Okay. All those in favor? Aye, opposed, abstained. Thank you. Okay. Next is approval of minutes. We have before us the minutes of our regular Board of Finance meeting of September 18th. And I will move acceptance of the minutes of September 18th as presented.
Second.
Any discussion, adjustments, et cetera?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
That meeting took place on something other than the third Thursday of the month. And I was unable to attend because of that change. I don't remember the change in the scheduling of that meeting. I've been through the minutes of the August meeting. I don't find anything to suggest we discussed it. And so I guess I have a question about how that change came to pass.
No, September 18th.
I think, what did we discuss it in July?
We didn't have a July meeting.
No, but there was a reason.
We didn't meet in July.
I suppose it had to be June.
I don't think it did.
No, but there was a reason. I'm trying to remember. The board selected that the night before, and we couldn't, I don't know if we couldn't meet on Thursday for some reason. I don't remember. Of course, Karen's not here.
Interesting. It was posted, but I don't remember why either.
Was it a holiday?
No. Honestly, don't recall. I got your email, but I don't recall why we moved it to the conflict on the.
I don't feel so. If no one remembers, I don't feel as bad.
Honestly, I don't remember. I know we said what we'd be on Tuesday. I don't remember why.
And the reason I ask is because I think the Board of Selectmen rises above any incarnation of it and should meet as scheduled as often as possible, except under extraordinary circumstances. And if no one remembers, then maybe they weren't so extraordinary.
I just remember the Board of Selectmen, I believe, met the night before. For some reason,
the Board of Selectmen met the night before because the prior week was the holidays.
Holiday.
Yeah.
That's right. Why they met on
Tuesday. So the question is, why did we move our meeting up to Tuesday and I keep on through? I don't know, Michael, was that a conflict for you?
It was the first one, yeah.
Okay, so that might be the reason.
It's just like shopping around. This meeting, yeah. Both boards together.
Well, this meeting is a tri-board meeting. I think that's a little different than accommodating the schedule of one particular board member when residents might be looking for this meeting on the third Thursday of each month as it's scheduled to meet.
Must have been brought up in August. We didn't meet in July.
I didn't see anything in the minutes, and I don't remember anything, so that's why I asked. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? Any correction on the minutes?
I have a question, Matt. On the first page, under the status of the FY07 budget, in the last line, it says the fund balance is currently at $4.6 million and will go down to $4.2 million. In the notes that I left Karen, I questioned whether or not there should be some explication of that last statement that goes down to $4.2 million. If only that it might be the result of the monies that we've put into the budget.
I think that's right, the money we carry forward.
Correct, yeah.
Yeah.
It's because you appropriate money.
Yeah, maybe I'm lying explaining why. You know, why that's happening, because it's something that was part of the budget. We appropriated $400,000 from fund balance.
Correct.
To offset taxes. Right?
Yeah.
How can we get that to Karen?
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, just an explanation as to why. Okay, anything else? All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Abstained. Okay. First Selectmen's report. Ed and the Board of Selectmen are meeting in the back room, so he will not be here to give his report. He'll be here at 7 o'clock. So that brings us to liaison reports. And nothing much on Amity. That should be a brief.
There's something else in the packet.
Oh, about the oh yeah, that was FYI, the modulars for Amity. I guess the Amity kept some modulars.
We sent Amity M Space a personal property tax bill for modulars in Amity. M Space then in turn billed Amity for that tax amount. The reimbursement of a tax, not a tax. Mm-hmm. So Amity.
Our town attorney looked at Amity wanted to get the taxes waived.
So they wanted us to waive the personal property tax bill to M Space so that they didn't have to pay it, reimbursement for it. And we had our town attorney look into it.
There's no way
it's said we can't do that.
You can do that.
Right.
So we have to pay the taxes. So. Yeah, it can't be that much anyway. So.
It was
$26,000.
Fine.
They
should. Okay, as far as Amity is concerned, as we get further into the year, the surplus has remained about the same that's being projected, and that is approximately $1.6 million, which is a lot, as I said before. But it's primarily in the areas that I said before of health insurance and special ed and some unanticipated income from tuition. So, but it is holding at this point, so we'll see. Again, they haven't entered the heating season, so they don't really know what that's going to hold. But they are finding, for example, their electric is not. I guess the contractors gave them a building of a similar size that they constructed, and they gave them the kilowatt hours that building used, and they kind of used that as a basis to estimate it, and their electric use is coming in lower. So
it's just more efficient.
It could be. So I said that, you know, and Jack assures me, Jack Levine, the finance director, that next year in those areas it'll be a lot. There'll be a baseline to look at as far as that. So I believe they're going to renew the auditors. Which is Costin and Rufkus, although they are going to try and get some pricing to see if they're competitive. And then lastly, the budget calendar was released, and he should have his, he being the superintendent, should have his budget proposal ready by mid-January. So, yeah, that's good for
wow.
Right, remember? So yeah, so
yeah.
We'll have at least an idea of what they're thinking and what we're going to build into our budget for Amity. I think we're targeted for mid-January to talk about it. So, and he will again be coming before this gathering. He said, hey, Dr. Brady will come to this gathering to present the budget to us as he did last year. So that's about it. Nothing. The audits are very, very thorough. And as Jack Levine said, the orders are very demanding. So, but that's a good thing, because considering what we went through in the past, it's better that he has a lot of work to satisfy him than what we had in the past. So things continue to move along there.
Matt, excuse me, would you speak to something Tony alluded to, the status of the construction bonding and the district's ability to cover that in the absence of the state bond?
Yeah, well, Amity had to go out and borrow, I don't remember the exact number, they might have something there, but Amity had, I think it was $2.8 million or something like that, but they had to go out and borrow short term, because the state's not prepared to give it to them. And I had it somewhere, you know, we talked about it that night. And it's a problem, because if...
When does the state expect it?
I don't know, I guess it's never.
The governor vetoed the bill, so yeah. That question might be better directed at her office.
Yeah. And it's a, and the problem, one of the problems, again, that's a, more on a smaller scale than a lot of school districts, is the cost of borrowing, the bond cost, interest.
Lost interest, sure.
Yeah, and are we gonna then go to the state and say, because you guys couldn't agree on a bonding package, are you gonna now reimburse us for, you know, it was like $20,000, I believe, to go out and borrow this money.
Well, they're obviously sitting on funds that they're investing. So they're investing the funds.
So the state is.
The state is, so why, when they then in turn reimburse, I mean, they're sitting on funds investing them. These towns are all borrowing money because they're not getting the money as soon as.
Right, but what the state is, if you want to say withholding, or what the state is not providing to local municipalities and regional school districts in this case, is revenue generated from the sale of bonds. It's not, I don't know that there's money collecting interest necessarily at the state level in this regard, but it does cost money at the local level in one of two ways. Either the cost of borrowing money short term, as Matt describes, or if the district were to pay these bills as they come due, then the districts would, or the municipalities would start losing money on interest that might otherwise be earned. It is a problem, and the state, I believe, has been sued by a couple of large cities. I know there was that potential anyway, but...
Yeah, I think we have a big one coming up soon, too, a bigger one. So it was $2.57 million, just to carry it to the next level. The interest rate we got, we're going to pay on is 3.6094, which is pretty low. But there's a bigger problem coming down the road in the next... Big funding comes up, and it's a problem.
When is it scheduled to go back?
Well, the governor vetoed legislation that was passed the end of September, so now...
she's on vacation now, so another thing.
Yeah, she's very busy, right? She's very busy on vacation.
Yeah, we have no money to pay our schools, and she's on vacation in Colorado.
Now, new legislation is being drafted or negotiated, however you want to describe it. It's, you know, it's in the works, but it's still pending.
It's a big problem.
Yeah.
For us, it's not a huge problem, but for some municipalities, it's major.
Oh, the big cities. Oh. The big cities are
heavily
major.
The town of Woodbridge, so we don't have any.
No,
that's Woodbridge. We get looser funds. Right, we don't get those all off, like August.
It must. Hey, bridge. It's not just school
funds. Right. Losic funds, steep funds. It's a whole bunch of stuff that they mine for.
So hopefully they're gonna be in the mine soon.
And her problem with it was,
she felt there was too. The package improvements, if they're all correct, was too much.
Too big of.
Yeah.
Well, that's how she describes it.
Yeah. Sorry about the paper. That was her reason for vetoing it. So, Tony.
I had a conflict with the Board of Education Finance meeting, so I wasn't able to attend, but I think tonight, having a February meeting, which was really filling in, especially with capital items, so pass on that. As far as the public works, next Monday, we're scheduled to get the dome in place. So hopefully,
that's good.
Hopefully, everything will come. Yeah.
So then, are they going to deliver the sand and salt?
I'm not quite sure what the schedule is for sand and salt, but it should be.
We actually just went out to bid for that. And the sand, we have installed a lot from last year.
Oh, good.
So we didn't really bid much, and we probably won't get delivery until January or something. But salt, we're gonna try to time that so that we wait till after the structure is.
When it's falls, then maybe.
Yeah, right.
I don't know how, I mean, this is prefab. It's supposed to come in on Monday. I don't know how long it takes them to put all the components together.
We're hoping to have everything by the end of the month.
Oh, wow.
Which is next Thursday.
Next month.
Oh,
in December.
I was going to say, boy, that is pretty fast. Because
they have to put the walls up first, then the walls got to cure, and then they got to put the structure.
That'd be good if you get it in before.
Well, that's the intent, to get it in before the season.
Oh, wow.
Which is, it's still, you know, close, it's tight.
Yeah.
I guess also we've gotten beyond it, but I guess there was an issue still with the quality of the dirt. So we ended up having to import dirt to compact in the end. So little extra cost for that too.
Yeah, I heard a question.
$15 or so?
I don't think it was that much. No, it was five.
About $5,000.
It was $5,000.
That's done though, that part of that, remember?
Yeah.
We talked about it, that's done.
It's done.
That was from the bottom, did it?
Yeah.
That's good, that's good.
Okay.
That's it, and I'll probably wait next couple weeks for the next phase, we haven't done that yet. That's it.
I got all botched up with the library, because they moved the thing. I always forget that in, it's Columbus that I moved the date, so I missed that one. But I did make the fire commission meeting. There seems to be a problem that just doesn't want to get resolved here. The fire, you gotta understand, I'm not just sometimes going to use it for the. We have 400 amp breakers. The thing has tripped like four friggin' times. These people are getting all upset, I actually don't blame them. We've gone through 250 gallons of diesel fuel in 30 days.
For the generators?
For the generator, because this thing keeps tripping. And what they keep saying is why aren't we hiring someone with experience to come out and figure out what the problem is with this thing? This has to do with
the electricity.
Which is electricity and coming into the trailers and everything. I mean, this has been going on, I have to be honest with you, this has been going on.
Awesome.
This discussion started in, I think, July. I listen to the same problem every month and it doesn't seem like it wants to get fixed. What, is there anything we could do to help this situation?
Yeah, I think the best person to speak with is Joe.
Well, where'd he go?
He's at the board selection meeting at the moment. When he comes in.
Yeah, when he comes in, maybe
we
exactly.
think we need to ask him, because they're trying to be prudent about things. They're going through oil, and they're concerned about, you know, even possibly, you know, it's 400 amps, you know. It should be, could cause a problem from an electrical standpoint. No, we don't want electrical problems at this point. So, okay, well, we can talk.
I guess it's been flustering. It's been flustering people. I've watched meetings where Joe's talked about it. And, I guess the UI has been down many times.
There's been a lot of work done on this, and I don't pretend to be any sort of expert
either.
So I would ask.
Before we get started. Why aren't we hiring an engineer?
You can ask that question.
To look at this thing. So that's that. And just to forewarn you, they're putting together the capital budget. And the big ticket items are three. Tanker A, the ladder truck, and an engine 7 pumper. So it's about a couple million.
When do they want these?
Oh,
we'll
see it when you get
anything else yet?
No, that's all I have.
Michael?
Police commission met on October 3rd. There has been an increase in activities under the category of burglaries over at Ford Road, Lisa Road, Cross Hollow, and Emerald.
That was me. That was Miles.
So they have been upping the patrols in those areas. There's also been some racing going on Ford Road down near the farm, the Mazzaro farm. They've been increasing the surveillance of that. For the first time, our police department had to make use of a taser, and it went very well. The person who was unable or unwilling to cooperate with the police came into line.
Didn't go too well for him.
But it's interesting, there were four drug arrests in the previous month. And the report about the SRO officer over at Amity is very positive. Dr. Brady is pleased. There were five drug arrests listed at Amity, six referrals to outside agencies, and the thing that the police commission felt best about was that the reports of the deputy chief is that the students are coming to the SRO officer and starting to get a relationship with him. So the person that was selected is absolutely a tight fit for this position, and it's what we want. We want students to say, did you know that something might be happening? That's the way it should be, and for them to get familiar with that SRO officer. We are still having a disagreement with the first selectman of Bethany in reference to payment of their proportional share. I was indiscreet enough to raise the issue with the first selectman of Bethany after church two Sundays ago and got both barrels straight in the chest, that they're not willing to pay more than an hourly rate and that all the other costs associated to the town of Woodbridge for covering the SRO officers for all three towns, they have no interest in. She also said that she had heard from Ed, the letter that he referred to at our last meeting, and had requested back that there be additional talk about it, but that has yet to happen. I think the best thing about that is that we do have the proper situation now at the high school with an SRO officer in there for 180 days who's fitting in. He's finished all his training and such. So that was a good meeting. May I interject another report? Earlier, Lawrence questioned why the September meeting of the Board of Finance was moved back 2 days, and I said, well, you know, it was the first symphony of the season. However, I am pleased to tell Lawrence that that is not the reason it was moved. November 14th of 06, we received the proposed calendar of Board of Finance meetings, and under the month of September, it is listed as Tuesday, September 18th, due to Yom Kippur. So it wasn't just the fact, as George says, that I've heard it all before and I don't actually know.
Yom Kippur is on Saturday.
Well, this, this is the document that we received as a Board of Finance in November of last year, and it says the 18th would be the meeting.
I don't want to belabor this, but it is quite disturbing that we have three towns in on this high school. We have three towns, or four towns, in on the animal shelter thing. And all of a sudden now, we're going to have towns saying, excuse me, I don't want to pay my share. I mean,
there's going to be more discussion on this.
You know, so we could sit back and say, we don't want to pay our share, then who's going to pay?
Well, what's troubling to me, especially, is you were at that meeting, Michael, you were there.
Yes.
She was the most vocally in favor of the SRO situation and sharing it amongst the three towns as opposed to having Amity put in their budget.
Right.
And for her now to hit you with two barrels, what is her justification? I mean, the officer costs us his salary plus benefits. I mean, what does she think? He has no benefits. So how can they not pick up their share of the benefits when he's spending all his time?
That's what I'm saying. If we sit back and say we're not going to pay, can Orange come back and say we don't want to pay?
Well, that would be wonderful, wouldn't it?
Yeah. I mean, this is getting...
The benefits are...
That's part of the utility. That's part of the deal.
Of course.
Deal.
Of course.
If I could paraphrase her bottom line, it's only 180 days, and we only want to pay an hourly rate. The rest of it is your cost.
Well, then we should have the hourly rate to incorporate the benefits, that's all.
Put it in an admin charge.
Yeah, I'll be perfectly honest with you, I'm not afraid to say this, but Bethany has always been this way. When you had the teen center funding, they never wanted to put in money for that. It's always been that way.
We should bear the burden.
I'd be happy to go to the Board of Finance or the Board of Selectmen meeting.
That takes care of three towns.
Just explain to me why they don't feel that's part of the SRO's compensation.
Well, if I remember what Ed said when this first came up, part of it is just what's institutionalized in Bethany, because they're not accustomed to paying a police department.
True, yeah, public safety.
They have a resident trooper, and the idea is foreign to them, I guess. If I understood that correctly,
it can't be foreign to them. I take the cost of somebody and person needs to get their benefit, and I divide that by something, and that's how much I have to pay.
Well, right.
Well, I'll tell you, if that's the case, then I'm all for having Amity take the SRO guy and add him to their budget.
They won't, why wasn't that?
And why won't they do that at this point? We're paying for it.
What it boils down to, David, on that is, when the SRO was in the Amity budget, and they were being demanded to come in with a certain percentage on the budget, and they had to choose between an SRO or a biology teacher, there was no discussion. You know, the superintendent felt there was no reason to even talk about it. He didn't go with the biology teacher. And also, he has no control over this person. The person
the superintendent.
He has no authority. He can't raise a salary, lower a salary, dock him a pay, or whatever. It's true. He's completely under the control of the Woodbridge Police Department, so why should he be an employee of Amity?
Well, you can say that about the pool, though. They use our pool and they pay us a fee. Mm-hmm. Why don't they just pay us a fee, add it to their budget, and then we don't have to deal with, this is your share, this is my share, I'm not going to pay my share.
Well, because the pressure came from the towns to put in the SRO. They were of the feeling they could handle it with their security guards and their program. So the towns insisted on this SRO, so then the town said, we'll pay for it. What difference does it make? We put it in our budget or put it in their budget?
Well, obviously there is a difference because Amity, Bethany thinks it's different.
So
to me, there is no difference.
No, I'll talk to Ed. As far as I'm concerned, I'd be happy to go to a meeting up there. Just have them explain it to me as to how they feel that's a fair way of handling it. We'll just pay his salary, but not his medical benefits and his retirement benefits. He's devoting 100% of his time there. How can you possibly justify that? Although, believe me, I don't know who he ran the Amity budget. They had some strange ways of justifying things.
I understand.
They're not easy
to
deal with. They look at things differently than we do.
I understand.
In all areas.
There was a federal grant for 3 years, and when they said, well, we aren't getting any more money, so we, the Amity board, can't afford it anymore.
Thanks. The Human Services Commission met October 1st. Two things of monetary value, I guess I might say. Tony, I'm sure Mary Ellen is keeping you current with this. There is the significant risk of a shortfall in the Senior Center of Transportation program, which has to do with a federal grant that the New Haven Regional Transit Authority receives and used to distribute to area towns to a greater extent. The Regional Transportation District is now holding on to more of that federal grant, so more will fall to the area towns. So they're looking at a potential shortfall of something, what was said that night, $9,000 to $11,000 for FY08. I'm sure the director will keep the town current as that goes. Along those lines, there was a great deal of discussion about raising rates that seniors are charged to help underwrite that program, and the increased rates would help mitigate that shortfall. So they're not taking it sitting down. So anyway, and then the other thing of a budgetary nature, as Janet reported with the Fire Commission, they're working on the capital budget presentation, which is coming. Two things. Pending, and the timing, I guess, is still flexible, but a new bus is on the horizon, a new minibus for the seniors, and a new stove for the kitchen, which is used in the senior center. So that's, and then the youth services division of our human services department is expecting, she sounded quite optimistic, a $5,000 grant from the Connecticut Department of Education. Which wouldn't necessarily be a revenue. They would have to spend the money if they get it. But anyway, that's a nice piece for them. just to report on the Cable Advisory Council, because I sometimes do that, the last I heard, and Pua, I'm sure, could provide more current information, but Woodbridge is scheduled for mediation with this, the third-party provider for our government access television. Woodbridge was scheduled to mediate with this Soundview Community Television after Orange, and the Orange mediation, I guess, happened last week, and as I understand it, there was no progress made during a 2.5-hour mediation session. So that puts the Woodbridge mediation session in limbo, and the money part of that is there's a $10,000 grant in this, potentially, although Soundview made arrangements to provide $10,000 to Milford 6 months ago, and Milford is still waiting for that. So there's some question about where that grant is or if it's even real. But
Milford received their money.
Milford did get its money, so that's new to me. But anyway, we're still waiting to see how that shakes out on the cable television front. And then
do you know what the problem was with the Orange?
Well, it has to do with town-specific programming versus regional programming. And Orange has, in our six town area two, Orange has the flagship government access television.
So it's the timing of giving up time and getting time.
Exactly.
And so that was the negotiation. Right.
We have a very good program here, and ours is modeled after Orange. Orange is understandably reluctant to give up time to a regional programming where residents would be watching Stratford or Fairfield or Woodbridge, for that matter. Orange is reluctant to give up their town-specific programming. This third-party provider based in Bridgeport would prefer, and is citing a DPUC ruling, saying, oh no, we get to decide what you watch and when you watch it. So it's rather contentious and ongoing.
Sounds like you could stretch a lot.
The DPUC decision is a year old already, so it's been going, yes. And then just one more note, the Firehouse Reinvention and Reuse Explorers, I call us, the FIREs, met one night last week. It was an organizational meeting. We toured we can start calling the old firehouse, I guess. We received blueprints and the process for dividing up that building and determining its future. I represent this board on that.
I attended the Recreation Commission meeting on Monday, September 24th. Of financial interest, they debated the fee structure for the Woodbridge Aquatic Club. There's a club that pays an hourly rate, and then they've had some programs for family memberships at a reduced rate, and that had been debated before, so I was sort of coming in the middle of the process, but it's still an ongoing process. The Allegi fields are going to be closed next summer, as I understand it, for maintenance, receiving, that sort of thing. And that was about it for that meeting. They had another meeting this past Monday, but I couldn't attend that because I was at the Firehouse Building Committee. I'm happy to say that is on schedule and on budget as of now. They're going to be sending out some initial bid packages, I think within the next couple of weeks. Is that for the summer time?
For the fire station?
Yeah.
They actually were released today.
Ah, okay.
The legal will be in the paper tomorrow for four packages for site work, steel, and a couple others. They're due the 14th of November.
In the original plans, there had been a traffic light and a crosswalk in front of the fire station, the Department of Transportation has nixed that. They won't put a light in a crosswalk on a state highway. That's appealable, but the committee decided that the odds of succeeding were slim to none, so it's not going to be appealed.
Do they have a date scheduled for possible robbery?
Late November.
Late November. At the second Board of Selectmen meeting, they're hoping to get approval on the bids, and then shortly thereafter.
So this actual thing, I'll have.
There, that's like two, that's like 3 minutes for four.
Is there anything else?
What time is it?
Jeez, you believe this?
All right, here we go.
Right on the button. Motion to adjourn. I'll second it all over the paper. That's first or what?
How about that?